Good day, good day, good day. It is Tuesday, November the 24th, and welcome to another Tuesday with Thom, brought to you by the Best Girl Consulting Firm. Best Girl consults with utilities, higher ed institutions, associations, and large nonprofits to customize solutions that support your bottom line. It is Thanksgiving week, time for family, food, fun, and the beginning of the holiday season. Yay! Today, Barbara Wallace Edwards and Mychal Walker are here. Our G-List guest is scheduled to be Eric Jones from Houston, Texas. Remember, Hollywood's got the A-List, and here on Tuesdays with Thom, we have the G-List. Eric is a composer and a lyricist. We will talk about the 25 hit to produce this project called the 25 Songs of Christmas. And he's working on a proposed film for the Nat King Cole story. So we look forward to that. Before we get to our interviews, let's catch up on what's going on. Thanksgiving is here. I'll say that again. I'll say yay again. And many of us have much to be thankful for. I know the pandemic has changed our lives. I know the self-quarantine has been difficult on a lot of people staying at home, especially if you have small children. But there is so much to be thankful for, so many wonderful things that go on in our lives daily. I've given some thought to it. What am I thankful for this year? Well, there are many, many things I feel I'm thankful for, but I'm going to boil it down to just five. Number one, my family. I want to thank them for the love they give me on a daily basis. It makes life worth living. Thank you. I want to thank you to my extended family, whether that's by birth, marriage, or just through love, including the team I get to work with every day. The princes, the communicator, the posse, the organizer when we find him or her, and Mychal and Barbara from Tuesdays with Thom. Thank you all. Number two, I'm thankful for my friends and associates, many whom I've known for years. Those I grew up with, went to school with, went to college with, played ball with, and worked with over the years, and others who have come into my life recently. They make the things I have to do on a daily basis fun and enlightening. Thank you. Number three, I'm thankful for the mentors and educators that I've had influence in my life. The great business mentors I had in Birmingham, they are a part of the reason that I've been able to not only survive, but thrive in my own business. And also in the world of theater, film, and television. The educators, man, I had some great educators in my life. Miss Horn, Miss Sykes, Mrs. Sykes, Coach Porter at John Carroll High School, Mrs. McGee and Sister Mary Carmella at Our Lady of Fatima School, Dr. Overstreet from Auburn, Carl Perkins from the University of Montevallo, and Thom Noonan from UCLA. Number four, I'm thankful for the life that I've lived and continue to live. I've been blessed to live what I call a Rover Boy life. Well, what's a Rover Boy life? I read the Rover Boy series of books as a child, and the Rover Boys were these three brothers who lived lives of adventure. The Rover Boys out west, the Rover Boys in Europe, the Rover Boys on the river, and at least another half dozen or so. I checked them out of this small library we had at Our Lady of Fatima Elementary School in Birmingham, and it was the beginning of a love affair I had with libraries. Through the Rover Boys, I dreamed that I, too, could have these adventures. And I'll tell you what's a great Rover Boy story. I was talking to my wife and my mother-in-law a few years ago, and I brought up the Rover Boys and how great it was. And on my next birthday, my mother-in-law surprised me with a couple of first edition Rover Boy books. These books, this one was written in 1909. This one is 1910. The Rover Boys on the Plains, the Rover Boys on Treasure Island. And I'm just so appreciative of that. And finally, I'm thankful that I'm able to enjoy the simple things and the many things I've enjoyed since childhood, like riding my bicycle and watching movies. In my neighborhood, those that don't know me simply know me as the Bicycle Man. I ride nearly every morning. I will ride Thanksgiving morning, weather permitting. Then my wife and I will sit down to a good meal. We'll watch a good movie. And somewhere along the middle of that movie, I'll have a good nap. And if it's a really good movie, when I wake up, she'll tell me I need to watch the rest of it, and then I'll watch the end of the film. Be thankful. Happy Thanksgiving. Okay, our two roundtable guests, Barbara Wallace Edwards and Mychal Walker, are here today. Barbara Wallace Edwards. Barbara is from Birmingham, Alabama, an Auburn University grad. She is a world traveler. And I'm waiting for her to come on. Hey, Barbara, how are you?
Good morning, Thom. I'm doing well this morning. Sort of recovering, though, from something I had over the weekend, which I think was just a stomach virus. I don't know yet, but feeling better today, thank God.
Well, good. What's your Thanksgiving plans?
I am staying home alone. It's going to be a solo kind of a holiday for me. Again, I don't want to go around family and friends not knowing exactly what I had this past weekend and still may not be fully recovered from. So had plans to do some traveling and to be with family, but decided to stay home and just kind of stick it out alone this time.
Okay. Well, I've done that. I think I told you guys one of our favorite Thanksgivings was in Los Angeles. We went down to the beach and hung out at the beach for a while and then had hamburgers and hot dogs and french fries and milkshakes. And it was great.
Yeah. I'm gonna cook a meal, so I'll have food and I'll be going from my kitchen to my den to watch TV and back to the bedroom. So it's gonna be quiet.
You know, when growing up they had those great football games on Thanksgiving. Oklahoma, Nebraska was always on, and the Cowboys played somebody, and the Cowboys played somebody, and the Lions played somebody, and the Lions always lost. like, well, why do they keep bringing them on Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
All right, and our other roundtable guest is Mychal Walker. Mychal is president of the Walker Agency, a full-service insurance brokerage. Mychal lives in Atlanta, Georgia. And Mychal, how are you?
I am doing well this morning, Thom. Thank you very much. I hope you and Barbara both are doing well. And Barbara, I'm glad you recovered from whatever you had. Maybe it was just a 24-hour bug.
I think so. Well, thank you.
I don't mean to be whatever, but at least this is by Zoom, so you don't have to worry about contact to any of us.
Otherwise, we might have been on this morning.
Otherwise, we might have asked you to politely come back next week.
Stay away.
What's going on in your world? What you got going for Thanksgiving and what's happening in your world?
Well, first of all, as far as Thanksgiving, as they say, I think I'll be chilling like a villain. I'm just going to take it easy, try to expand my mind, my universe, and just meditate a little bit, you know, and relax and kind of get my mind ready for the close of the year.
It's interesting. I've heard so many people say that this year, that, you know, they're just going to take it easy. And I mean, that's my plan. I've been looking forward to actually Wednesday, because that's officially when I've told myself I can take off and relax.
Right.
Right.
Take a nap on the couch, man. And I do. I go to sleep. And I was watching a movie last night. I bet you I woke up twice and set it back to where it was and then went to sleep again before it ended. So I finally saw the rest of it. It was a good movie. So, Mychal, what's happening in your world?
Well, I'll tell you, from a healthcare perspective, there's a little bit of good news that I think you may find interesting, and perhaps this will catch fire. There's a U.S. Senate bill that will make the coronavirus vaccine free for Medicaid consumers. A senator out of Ohio, U.S. Senator Sherrod Brown of Cleveland, Democrat out of Ohio, he said that his bill would ensure that Medicaid consumers can receive vaccinations free, including the potential coronavirus vaccine currently in development. And it's aimed at people that are on Medicaid, but even on Medicaid, you do have some out-of-pocket expenses. And so it's supposed to eliminate that. And this bill, if it catches fire, it'll be great for everybody that are, even people that are in states that did not expand Medicaid, but they're on Medicaid.
Now, I know you're an insurance guy, but I'm going to ask you a political question. What are the chances of the bill passing, you think?
Well, actually, I think it's probably pretty good. The reason why I say that is because part of the bill sets up reinsurance to reimburse the carriers and the hospitals that administer the drug. So that's a good thing right there. And I think just in the climate that we live in, whereas a move to try to be a lot more compassionate and bring the country together, I think there's a good chance that it will pass.
Good. Hopefully so. Mychal, you, I think, are licensed to practice in 14 states. Is that?
That's correct. Yes. And that's including Florida, Alabama, Georgia, throughout the Southeast. Which is North and South Carolina, along with Mississippi, Tennessee, also in Texas, Baltimore, D.C. area, New York, Indiana, all over.
Mychal comes on and gives us great insurance tips. And so if, in fact, you're looking for some advice and some counsel in regards to insurance, Michael's your guy. I don't know if we can put a contact information up there for him. We'll get that on at least before the show is over, and I want to go back to Barbara. And Barbara, Barbara is retired but does a lot of community and charitable work. And so, if you got a nonprofit out there that needs some help, Barbara is your person, and we're going to put Barbara's information up there as well. But a matter of fact, before I move on, why don't you just give your contact information out that you're comfortable with people having?
Yes, most definitely. My email address, you can reach me at Edwards, EDWARDS, 2371 at bellsouth.net. That's the best way to contact.
Okay. Edwards, one more time.
Edwards, 2371 at bellsouth.net.
I'm always intrigued when people have numbers in their community, their email addresses, because those numbers always mean something. But I'm not going to ask
you those numbers. They really don't. It's just one that BellSouth assigned to me when I got the email address, and I kept it. So, email address.
Mychal, you got some contact information you want to put out there?
Sure. Yes, I'll make it easy. I have a 800 number. That is 1-855-WALKER-2. Again, 1-855-WALKER-2. And you can call there and leave me a message.
And is that too significant?
Well, that's just because one wasn't available.
Okay. All right. Well, anything else from either one of you?
Well, I just like to go back and revisit, Thanksgiving. And my memories from Thanksgiving always takes me back when I was a small kid living with my grandparents. And, it was always fun because leading up to it, my grandmother would always have this turkey, and she had this roaster that she put it in, so I knew it was fun times coming because she would begin a day ahead of time preparing the meals, and we would either have Thanksgiving at our home there in Auburn, or we go down to some relatives on my grandfather's side of the family in Montgomery and have Thanksgiving. And when we would go down there, it was always interesting because we'd always get in the backyard and play football because that's what's going on Thanksgiving.
That's right.
But like the two of you, I always wondered, why is Detroit always on? Because they're losing all the time. They never win.
And we go
in to watch Detroit lose again. And later I found out that it had something to do with when the Ford family brought the Detroit Lions in, they negotiated some type of an agreement where they had an opportunity to play on Thanksgiving, or they got a first right of refusal. So I was always wondering, you're not any good, so why are you playing?
They had Barry Sanders, so at least that part was good.
Yeah, yes. That part was good.
Eric's going to be our guest, and Eric says the Cowboys too. But the Cowboys were America's team back then, you know.
Yes.
They did win, and they had big stars, and they were fun to watch. I'll never forget. I don't know if it's Thanksgiving night, and they were playing Vikings, and Drew Pearson, I think, caught an incredible bomb, one of those Hail Mary passes at the end of the game. Right. It was just incredible. And then I remember one game, Emmitt Smith went 99 yards. They won the 1 yard line, and he burst through that, buddy, and it was like, hey, he's gone.
Well, did you also ever wonder at the end of the games when they'd have a big turkey out there and they'd pull off a drumstick like caveman style, how big the drumstick was? I always wondered, where did they find those turkeys? Because the drumsticks were huge.
Well, they had done that. They had to have a big drumstick. You know, the other thing I remember about Thanksgiving was, yeah, we had all this great food, so on and so forth. But man, and this was me and my dad is part of the food preparation. We always had homemade ice cream. And boy, Dad and I, we'd go and get a block of ice or whatever and some ice, and we'd put it in the – first, we had one of those old ice cream makers, which you had to crank. And then we had the crank itself, which was good for me. Oh man, it was such a great day. And then you know, you had dinner, and then you could sit down with the ice cream and the cake and watch the game. And it was great. So I always say Thanksgiving, yay.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else from either one of you?
Okay. Happy Thanksgiving to everybody that's out there listening.
There you
Absolutely.
Go. There
Happy you go. Thanksgiving to everyone.
Okay, well, we will take a break for our sponsor, Best Girl, and Lil M's going to put Best Girl up there for us. The today's show is sponsored by Best Girl, Inc. What is Best Girl? Best Girl is a consulting firm that provides customized leadership, access and inclusion, public relations, communications, and organizational consulting services. Our clients include Fortune 500 companies, utilities, higher education institutions, small businesses, and associations. We have a team of consultants led by Joyce Gilly Gossom and Miss Emily Hedrick, and they partner with business and education business clients to promote organizational effectiveness and education, motivation, and leadership. Our customized consulting services include strategic planning, corporate communications, executive coaching, fundraising, and some economic development. All right. Welcome back. Today, our G-list guest. And you know, Hollywood's got the A-list. And here on Tuesdays with Thom, we got the G-list, where everybody is a star. Our G-list guest today is Eric Jones. Eric is a composer, a lyricist, executive producer, and he is working on a couple of interesting projects. One is he's already produced the 25 Songs of Christmas. We're going to talk about that. And he's also working on a film, The Nat King Cole Story, which is, I think you'll all find to be very, very interesting. Eric was born in Medford, Massachusetts. He is a graduate of Texas Southern University, where he has a BS in pharmacy. He has been involved with the Christian Theater Circus since 1995 as a writer, actor, director, and composer. Eric, welcome this morning.
Well, hello, Thom. It's a pleasure to be here, guys. How's everybody doing today?
Oh, we're doing very well. Let me just tell you, I talked about recent friends I'd made. Eric and I were in a class this summer at UCLA, a production class. We were fledgling film producers. We were in a class with 50 people.
Mm-hmm.
It was virtual.
Yes.
And they were from all over the world. It was very interesting. There were
people. Yeah, it was amazing.
Australia. Yeah. Go ahead. You comment on it.
Yeah, it was amazing. I mean, it was great to get a chance to meet all these different people. And, you know, everybody had different types of experiences and different walks of life. And, you know, and I was this person that was kind of starting a second act. I started my career mostly in theater, and I'm moving towards film. So it was a pleasure to be able to meet all those different people, especially meeting you, Thom. It was a lot of fun.
Well, you say this is a second act, actually, it's kind of a third act for you because you went to school and you majored in pharmacy. And you were a practicing pharmacist for
Yes, I was. For 25 years. I graduated in 93. I've worked in mostly either in hospital, retail, you name it. I've done different types of disciplines. It was a great experience. I learned a lot. But in between the time I was doing that, I was always doing some form of entertainment. If I was writing or producing or writing a song or directing, they needed somebody. I was just always in the middle of it. But I had to kind of make a choice. So, about a couple of years ago, I decided that that's it. I'm just gonna step out on faith and just do this. Just do it full time. So. It was a good experience learning, practicing and dealing with, working with patients. But I really love working in entertainment. I really love creating work, creating content, writing songs. I just love it. I just love it all.
I got to ask you one question on your material. You're a lyricist, composer, and
librettist is a person who writes the script. So he's the scriptwriter. So that's usually the book of a musical. So if you ever watch a musical, you always want to know what makes that up. So usually, like, composers would be kind of like on the lines like a Stephen Sondheim or a Stephen Schwartz. They're also lyricists and composers. So they wrote the music and they wrote the words. There have been some people that have been known to write lyrics, words, and music. Like Jason Robert Brown's been known to do all three. So it's a really specific discipline. Some have the talent to do all three. Some people could just do one. That's why you have a team of three, or sometimes you just have like a team of two. So it all depends. Mostly I do a lot of lyric writing and book writing for my shows that I've written. Okay. So that's usually my strongest strength. My composing is kind of, it's okay, but I do my best. I do my best, but believe it or not, my lyrics are the bomb. They're the bomb. So
okay, if you have to say so yourself, right?
I have to say so myself. Yeah. Of course.
So let's talk about the 25 days. Well, we got Thanksgiving coming up, which is to me the beginning of the holiday season.
Absolutely.
And from here to January 1st, it's a party. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, the one thing I like about it, no disrespect to Thanksgiving, because I love Thanksgiving too. I mean, it's always been known to be kind of the holiday redheaded stepchild of the holiday season for all holidays in general, because it's always been first Thanksgiving, first you have Halloween, which is a lot of fun. Everybody enjoys it. Then Thanksgiving comes and they just get steamrolled by Christmas, which has always been such a big thing. But Christmas is something about Christmas. It's just the fact that it just brings everybody together. And I think particularly right now, especially during this time of the pandemic and the COVID season, I think people are really looking for joy. They're looking for something totally different. Cause I mean, we've had a rough year. So we need something to kind of give us some holiday cheers and some fun. And, I'm very honored to be a part of working on this project, which I've been doing for the last 11 years. This would be our 11th season doing this web series, so we're really excited.
Tell us about it.
Well, 25 Songs of Christmas is really, in the nutshell, it's kind of like a behind the music, or like the unsung. If people are familiar with the TV ones, Unsung, it's kind of like the behind the scenes of where your favorite Christmas songs came from. So each day is actually, we have 25 episodes in our web series, and it starts from December 1st until Christmas Day. So it's like every song, is from a different well-known artist. Sometimes they're, popular artists from various different genres, from jazz, blues, R&B, classical, you name it. So it's every type of music. But each song has a certain theme. So like some days, like if we deal with December, say December 6th, for example, I mean, that's St. Nicholas Day that celebrates St. Nick. So there's always going to be a song about Santa Claus. December 7th is Pearl Harbor Day, so we always do something to celebrate the troops. December 21st is the winter solstice, the first day of winter, so there's always going to be a winter song. So that's just guaranteed. And of course, 25 song, we're always 24th and 24th, we're always going to do some songs that are kind of sacred songs that deal with, with the true meaning of the holiday season about. But everything else is up in the air. It could be every type of song you can think of. Sometimes we make it a point to annually to never make, replay or repost the same holiday song every year. We do it maybe we kind of recycle it maybe once every 6 years, just to kind of keep your eyes fresh on what's going on. Most of the songs are usually most of our songs, I would say about 60% is usually public domain. Others are popular songs that have been around probably for the last 70, 80 years. So they're current, they're recent.
Okay. So I think you got some songs for us that we're going to maybe play some clips from, and then you're going to talk about them. So I'll turn it over to you.
I would love to. Okay.
I think Emily's going to help us out.
You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen, Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen, but do you recall the most famous reindeer of all? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose, and if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows.
I've never heard Gene Autry sing that.
Yes,
tell Gene us Autry. A little bit about that song.
Okay, well, thank you. I appreciate that. Yes. Well, Gene Autry actually recorded the song actually in 1949 by Johnny Marks. He wrote the music and lyrics. He's the same man. He's the same composer and lyricist who wrote. He wrote Frosty the Snowman and also Here Comes Santa Claus. So, and also Rocking Around the Christmas Tree. So he's a very popular, well-known songwriter for a lot of like Christmas songs. Now, when he received this, when he got this song, he absolutely hated the song. He hated the song. I mean, hated, literally hated it. No, Gene Autry, he hated it because he's known to be a cowboy singer. That's, you know, that's his reputation. So, and he said, "Oh no, I can't do this song. It's going to ruin my career." So it was his wife that talked to try to convince him. Said, "You know what? Let's just give it a shot. Let's just record it. And, you know, I bet you 9 out of 10 is probably going to be on the B side." Because he just released around the same time he just released Back in the Saddle Again, which is one of his well-known songs. So I said, okay, I'll do it. He recorded it. Wound up becoming probably one of the biggest hits of his entire career. Not only was it the biggest hit of his entire career, it made him so successful that he was able to buy a mansion right outside of, outside of Los Angeles over by the Pacific Palisades. He owns a big house over there. It's well known over there. So I think they call it the Santa Claus house because it would actually help pay for his career. So I always tell this story to all the people out there. Particularly, I tell that this is for all the husbands out there. I said, husbands, listen to your wives because it can change your life. So this is what made him famous. So.
Listen to your wives because it can get you a mansion out by Pacific
exactly, exactly, exactly. So it's very popular. And then, you know, of course, years later, of course, in 1964, you know, the Rankin and Bass, you know, they wrote some songs based, you know, on the animated series, which everybody knows and loves, which that's what I remember as a little kid watching growing up, watching the story of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. So, But it's a great song. It's always popular, and I think it's one of the few songs that kids actually know. They know.
Okay, and the other thing, I don't know if this song had anything to do with it, but he also owned the California Angels.
Yes, he did. Yeah. He did. That helped too. Thank God for that Rudolph money. That helped a lot.
Yeah.
Because exactly. Actually, what's really great is that he his Christmas recordings are actually much more more famous than actually some of his cowboy recordings. Okay. And his films. That's why people don't realize that. Yeah, it actually outsold than his cowboy films. So
he
never made fun of it ever again. He never like, okay, before that time he thought, this is ridiculous. It's a silly novelty song. Nobody cares about that stuff. But you never know. You never know.
Okay, well, let's see. I think you got something else.
And as we trim the tree, how much fun it's gonna be together. Christmas, the fireside is blazing bright. We're caroling through the night, and this Christmas will be a very special Christmas for me.
Okay. Oh. Donny Hathaway is always one of my favorites.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I tell you what, the best thing about this is that people don't realize that this year it marks the 50th anniversary of the release of that song. It was released in October of 1970. Song, of course, you know, you hear that wonderful voice. It's the late, great Donny Hathaway, man. Great, great soulful R&B singer, songwriter from Chicago. He actually wrote the music. The lyrics were written by Nadine McKenna. What's really I loved about the song is that when he was recording the song, he wanted to create a song that actually celebrates Christmas, but celebrated through an African-American perspective, because up to that point, most of the all the great Christmas songs were all written by white people. So there were no songs that really like celebrated us, you know, how we celebrated. Like, you know, you listen to the words like, this Christmas will be a very special Christmas for me. So it's like it's a personal thing for him.
Okay.
So, and I've always loved this song. It's played, has been popular in every, like, every African-American home. I bet you 9 out of 10, nine out of 10 of them will know this song. They may not know a lot of other songs, but they know this one. And he wanted to create a song that was also upbeat, that you can actually dance to. That's another thing, too, that was very unique. So he did very well. It was very successful. It's been very popular. And, of course, it's been also inspired a 2007 film starring Chris Brown and Loretta Devine. Everybody knows that film, too. That was a very popular song as well. And a popular movie.
Loretta Devine?
Yes.
Okay. I got to work with Loretta on Love Is, and she's just a wonderful, well, first of all, just a wonderful human being and a wonderful actress. And it was so much fun to work with her. I always cherish that.
Also, another cool trivia fact, people don't realize that was also Idris Elba's second major motion picture he did. It was this Christmas. Before he started working with Tyler Perry, he did, you know, some work with of course, he did Daddy's Little Girls, but it was that was the film that was a national, like a major motion picture from a major studio. So
before I forget, I'm going to do one more song. But before I forget, tell us where people can go and engage with the 25 songs of Christmas.
Wonderful. We have our own website. We actually have www.25songsofchristmas.com. We're always posting updates. We're going to be adding the new the new songs with the list. We have links. You can go to some of the videos on YouTube, so you can get a chance to see some of the, you know, the songs and the artists. And also we have we're doing something a little bit different this year, because we're doing a home edition, which is like our home for the holidays edition, where it's kind of a COVID theme. We do have some special artists that I know locally here from Houston, and there's other artists from different parts of the country that are going to be coming, and they're going to be performing some of those songs as well from their home. So we pre-recorded them, and I can't wait till, because right now we're scrambling, getting ready for the editing. We're trying to get as much done as we can. We're getting half of our material done just in time, for Christmas. So we're getting that ready. But that's 25 songs of Christmas .com. And you can also check our Facebook, Twitter, and also Instagram. We're on 25 Songs of Christmas. Okay. You can't miss it.
25 Songs of Christmas.
Yes.
Okay, sounds good. Let's listen to one more song here.
Okay.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at your nose, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe help to make the season bright.
Oh man, that's beautiful.
Yes, one of my personal favorites. Yes.
Tell us about it. Before we I'm going to get you to tell us about that, and we'll bring Mychal and Barbara on.
Sure.
We'll talk a little bit about the Nat King Cole project.
Sure, absolutely.
Tell us about that.
Everybody knows that. That is the one and only. That is Nat King Cole. That's the Christmas song. It's Merry Christmas to You. He released that song in 1961. It was 1 year after he had his very first Christmas album the year before in 1960. Very, very interesting story. The song, the music was written, of course, written by the, you know, by the late great Mel Torme. Lyrics written by Robert Wells. The song was actually written in 1945. Here was the thing that's very interesting about this song. When Robert Wells and Mel Torme, they were working at the Capitol building in Los Angeles, outside of Hollywood. And it was in the middle of the summer. It was like, I mean, I'm talking about like in August, like dog days of summer. It was extremely hot. And they were trying to come up with some songs that Mel Torme was going for his album. They kept writing. He kept writing and writing, writing. And they were just burning up because I think the air conditioning was out. So, and Mel Torme just told him, I said, told Robert, think cool thoughts. So just think cool thoughts, because I know it's hot. Just think of something cool. So the first thing that came to Robert's mind when he's writing his pen, he said, he wrote chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost was demanding notes. Those are the first lines that open it. And then, you know, Mel said, oh, perfect. Let's start that. So immediately they started working on it. And sure enough, the song was complete. They said, great, let's go ahead and record this. Now, here was the thing. The song was originally intended for Mel Torme. He was supposed to sing that song. Every time they did like maybe about 14 or 15 takes of the song, it just didn't work. It was something about it. It just didn't work. So it just so happens that Nat King Cole, and this took place like in 1946.
Wow.
Nat King Cole was actually he had his trio, his famous trio. They were recording because he was an artist with Capitol Records. He happened to walk in, heard what they were doing, and then Mel Torme said, "You know what? There's something about the song. It's just not working. I don't know what it is." And then you had the idea, "Hey, you wanna give it a shot? You wanna try this song?" I said, "Okay, sure. Okay, I'll give it a shot." Three takes, took the second take, and that's not the actual recording that you hear on the radio. I mean, you know, on the, you know, the final recording, but that song became Nat King Cole's song.
Wow.
So it took about probably until 1961 when Ralph Carmichael did the string arrangements for the song. He changed it. So everything that you hear right now was the 1961 version. That arrangement is what everybody knows.
Okay. So,
but here's the thing. It's like, just when you think that you're writing a song that's for you, it may not always be for you. It's supposed to be meant to be for somebody else. And that became one of many of Nat King Cole's signature songs. So,
man, that's incredible. Yeah, I think you were just biding your time to get out of pharmacy, because obviously this is your bailiwick here. I'm going to bring Barbara and Mychal on. And we can go back and forth to the 25 songs of Christmas.
Sure,
and Nat King Cole. So just, we've talked about 25 songs of Christmas. So before we go, just tell us a little bit about the Nat King Cole project, and then we'll Mychal and Barbara jump in.
Well, I'm really excited right now. I'm working on a script development of This Is Nat King Cole. This is actually a musical biographical comedy. And it's about Nat King Cole and his start from the start of the Nat King Cole Show from 1956 to 1957. So it talks about just a slice in the life of Nat King Cole. So it talks about the struggles of you know, the upturns and the downturns of just being the first African American to have an actual variety show on national television at the time, which is, there was none. So he was kind of like the Jackie Robinson of TV. So it was, so there's like, you know, ups and downs. So just imagine it being kind of like a cross between Ray and My Favorite Year. Has a really, that's like, so it's all the antics, all the crazy stuff that goes behind the scenes, but it's just that amazing music. So and just that just amazing voice and that amazing story about who Nat King Cole was.
I didn't realize he was the first African American to have a live variety show.
Yes, he was. Yes, he was.
I didn't know that. Barbara, you want to jump in here, and what do you got for Eric?
Yes. Thank you. Eric, thank you so much for sharing all that historical information about those songs. That really brings a new meaning to the songs for me. I love Christmas. It's my favorite time of year. And of course, I love Christmas music. And the Christmas song and This Christmas are two of my very favorites. So again, thank you very much for that. But I want you to share with our viewers, and I'm interested in knowing as well, how did you, I mean, you seem so passionate about music and you know, the theater and all of that. So, and arts, but pharmacy to music, how did you decide to major in pharmacy from the very beginning?
Well, it's kind of interesting because Well, here's the thing. My father was an Air Force physician. So, and also my mom was a nurse. So I came from a medical background. Everybody, it's funny. My sister's a nurse. My mom's a nurse. My grandmother's a nurse. My great grandmother was a nurse. They just came from health. That was just something that you did. You just, when you grow up in school, you're going to be a part of that. So it's just a part of our DNA. Right. But we also were very much passionate about arts. You know, we had collections of cast albums. We loved music. We went to concerts. We went to theater productions. We loved movies. So my father always believed that, you know, that your right brain should always be in sync with your left brain. So you should be able to see both sides. So that's where that kind of came from.
Great. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Mychal?
Good morning, Eric. How are you today?
Good morning. How are you doing today?
I am doing well. I got to say, I really appreciate having you on. And, you know, you hit it right out of the park with Donny Hathaway for me. That's one of my all-time favorites.
That's,
you know?
Right.
Hey, that's a player's Christmas song right there.
That's right. Well, I told people that's the song that's probably like the number one song among African-American people. When it comes to holiday songs, so that
right. And then you brought in the smooth voice of Nat King Cole, mm-hmm. who's a Montgomery, Alabama native. That's where I used to spend a lot of Thanksgivings here. But I got to ask you this: I'm sure you have this in your repertoire, but what about the Temptations and Silent Night?
Well, here's the thing I love about that version, because I mean, well, let's start with the history of the song. People don't really know about that. Now, you know that Silent Night, of course, was written by it was music was by Franz Gruber. And John Moore, they were Austrians. Moore was an Austrian monk who had a church outside of Salzburg. They of course the story goes is that they were going to create this incredible oratorio, but unfortunately the church's organ was busted because I think they had rats that messed it up. So they had to think of how we're going to do this song. How am I going to do this song? So Franz Gruber actually took a guitar, was practicing, played some of the chords and the music, and Moore wrote the lyrics, and it became Silent Night. Silent Night was just a very quiet, intimate, you know, showed the true birth of Jesus Christ in the nutshell of that manger. So it wind up becoming probably the most popular holiday song. It was released in 1818, and it was actually translated literally in 225 languages around the world.
Wow.
Because it's so simple and easy. Now, get into the Temptations, Motown. Now, there have been a lot of versions of that song. I think a lot of people have always thought that the song had to be big and elaborate when really it's supposed to be silent. Now, Berry Gordy, he knew that they needed some soul. So when the Temptations released that in 1970, they did that version, that well-known version, everybody knows that. And it just, he added lyrics that was not in the original text of the song. So, and I do remember because I loved it very much. It was like, okay, you made it more, he turned it more of an intimate, sacred song into kind of like a gospel R&B, like, you know, hello, I'm gonna praise, I'm gonna run around in church kind of song. So yeah. that's what they did, and I think it's also a very popular recording. I think they reissued it several times. Probably that they did an album called Give Love a Christmas Day. Yeah. They did that in 1980, and they just kept going on and on. But it was like many different versions. But everybody always goes back to that Temptation version. I love that version too. I really do. I like that. I love the version. I prefer it to be a little bit more intimate. If you really understand the meaning of the song, it is an intimate moment, and the music doesn't have to be too over the top or elaborate. But every time I hear the Temptations version, it puts a smile on my face. It makes me smile though. Mm-hmm. It makes me smile.
Christmas songs make you smile. They really do.
Oh yeah.
They do.
Barbara, you got another question?
Yeah, I was going to ask you about your work in the church. I see that you're the drama director for a church. Tell me a little bit about that and what that involves.
Well, let me see. Well, currently, right now, I'm one of the co-directors for Axe Drum Ministry at Word of Restoration. It's in Fresno. It's outside of Houston, Texas. I've been with them for about 7 years. We've done. My mindset is basically I want to create kind of like a community theater in the church. It's something that I do on the side besides my own personal projects. And first time we started working on our productions, ironically, was a Christmas musical. I've always tried to prepare them, train them as if they're working in as a community theater. I always had that kind of mindset. I think that drama ministries usually tend to be like, you know, little babies in the bathrobes and wearing the, you know, going that kind of thing. I think it's more than that. I feel like that, you know, there's a level of excellence and professionalism that should be involved, but also there still should also be a focus on, you know, on the biblical scripture and how things could be utilized properly in the word of God. So, I've always believed in kind of the combination of those two and merging those disciplines together. And, We've been pretty successful, you know. Right now, obviously, with COVID, it's been kind of difficult. It's probably not safe to really do any productions, you know, because without, you know, the social distancing, we may probably contemplate on doing maybe some kind of a project where we might do it via Zoom and create some ways we can do that way. You know, there's a lot of innovative ways we can, you know, create theater or create some sort of you know works of content that way, but. But right now, we really haven't been inside of my church right now for maybe about like 9 months right now. So it's been kind of, it's a little stir crazy, but eventually we'll get back to
for
it.
All of us.
For all of us, yes. For all of us. Oh, yes. Absolutely. All
right.
Mychal, you look like you got something else here you want to say.
Well, yes. I like to ask Eric to switch hats. I already know you're versatile because of your career changes. So I'm going to ask you to switch hats here for me.
Sure.
And put on your pharmacist hat.
You got it.
And tell me, what's your position on the vaccines that are coming out now to combat the coronavirus? And as a pharmacist, what would you tell the citizens of the United States about these vaccines?
Well, here's the thing. I tell people, number one is that, you know, right now, pharmacists and all the health professionals and essential workers right now, we are all trying to right now to kind of get the understanding of the effectiveness, the efficacy of, you know, the vaccines. Cause I know we got two companies right now. We got, you know, AstraZeneca is working on it. They said that they have about 95% effectiveness, which is a good thing. So I would say that once we kind of get the facts, the information, the data that's in, we will basically, they will proceed. I know that they're going to be doing. I know they just finished the trials right now. So once everything is all said and done, and there's some effectiveness, then and those drugs are going to be distributed. I mean, we will follow the procedure. I know that there are some pharmacists right now that are certified to do the injection themselves, actually, because you know they have to be certified. I'm not. I mean, because I'm retired. I'm not certified, but I know that current pharmacists that are practicing, they will be instructed. There'll be protocols and laws and training that they got to understand before they do that. So I think that once this thing is going to be effective, I think it's probably going to be effective it's going to be distributed to the general public sometime maybe in April of next year. I know it's going to be a 2021 thing. Think it's going to be right now. No, it's not. No.
Right.
You have to understand this vaccine. It's almost kind of like on the lines of what happened in 1954 with the Jonas Salk's polio vaccine. Now, they didn't do it immediately. They had to do it in stages. They had to do it in different stages. You know, some people can't take, there's some folks that can't take injections. Some people have to do it early. Some people have, you know, because they have like the sugar cubes and stuff. So I don't know. I mean, that's way before people's time. I mean, I remember that because my mom and dad told me stories about that. So, but I think that what's happening with this is kind of similar to what's going on with the Jonas Salk.
Okay. I'd like to follow up from the psychology of it.
Sure.
And now I'm speaking to the African American community because there seems to be some type of trepidation, if you will, or suspect in getting a vaccine like this, namely because of the history, like the Tuskegee experiment and what have you. And, you know, throughout these trials, they were asking for more participation from African Americans to come in during the trials, and very few would do so. So from a psychological standpoint, what would you say if you're just talking to the African American community about getting this vaccination?
Well, I say in all seriousness, I really think that we really need to provide the data to the general public to know exactly what is entailed of the vaccine. I do understand the trepidations of some people because, yes, we do have that history of being human guinea pigs in, you know, in the medical profession. That goes all the way back from the, you know, all the way back to, you know, to the, you know, to the early 19th century. We've been doing, you know, they've been doing horrible experimentations on us. And I can understand the fear. I can understand the intimidation is like, oh no, I'm not gonna do that. But I would think that with with this current administration right now, well, in the next administration, I think Biden's administration, I think they're gonna be a little bit more, transparent. I'm hoping they'll be more transparent and open their, you know, hearts to the people and let them know, hey, listen, you know, I think the vaccine will be effective. I think, you know, since the data that's currently coming out right now is precise and sound. I would actually allow them to, you know, provide that, you know, that, you know, that education to the, you know, to the general public. Say, hey, listen, this will work. This will be effective, you know, and it has worked on these group of people. I would say more right now, I'm more on the line of a wait and see, wait till they get the data, make sure that everything's complete before they would, you know, distribute it to everyone else. I know people are just like, I'll be the first one to sign up. I said, well, if you want to be the first one to sign up, go ahead and do it. But just be aware that just like in any new vaccine, any medication, any drug, there's always going to be adverse reactions. So you have to be aware of it. So just, you know, it's just kind of a part of the game. It's part of the, you know, not really the game. I may not be the right word to say the game, but it's just a part of the process of the, you know, of drug distribution. I've seen it, you know, over the years. So new drugs that are out on the market, some are great. I used to love Zantac when I was a kid and when I went to school. Now Zantac, you know, causes tumors. You can't take them anymore. They're off the market.
Right.
So you never know. Mm-hmm. These things happen sometimes. You know, yeah. You just have to continue to just be prepared for it. And if you see things that are not, you know, not effective for some people or could be harmful, you just have to just take the precaution, take the responsibility, and just, you know, hey.
Okay. Barbara.
Again, I just want to thank you for joining our show today. It has been very interesting. And what's your next project? Yeah, after the 25 Songs of Christmas, what's next for you?
Well, currently right now I'm in the process. Of course, we're developing the you know, This Is Nat King Cole story. Mm-hmm. I also have working on two musicals. Hopefully, obviously theaters are, fortunately, they're closed right now, but we already have like three, musical productions that we're already in the starting of the workshop phase. I have one show called White Man's Burden that's going to be presented at the Beck Center outside of Cleveland, Ohio, and it's kind of like it's a 15 minute musical. We won a contest called from the National Alliance of Musical Theater. It's a 50 minute musical theater challenge, where we had to come up with something in between the time of COVID. And it's like, this musical is kind of like one of those Time Life commercials, but it deals with our struggle. It deals with African-American struggle and talks about people being killed. So it talks about black men being murdered because of the color of their skin. So it's called White Man's Burden. That's one. That's going to be in mid-February during Black History Month. Another show I'm doing right now, I'm developing a show called Fire the Musical. And it talks about, people losing their jobs during COVID. So that's one. That's one of them. My only COVID musical ever done. So I don't know if I'll ever do another one again. But then our last one, I'm doing a show called American Skin, and it's a musical about people who have been killed because of the color of their skin. And I've worked on that. I've done a workshop back on September 11th, and now we're going to be developing it. Hopefully next year, sometime for with Create Theater in New York. We're trying to get that together. So yeah, so I've been kind of busy working on shows and films, and also I'm also going back to school. I'm getting my MFA in screenwriting at Houston Baptist University, so should be graduating sometime in spring of 22. So I'm already finishing my fall semester, and so I'm looking forward to it. I can't wait. I mean, I'm loving it and I'm learning. And so that's what I'm doing is writing and learning. That's what I'm doing, writing and learning.
I see we're getting an email from UCLA that we're getting our certificates soon.
Yeah, good. It's about time, man. I'm ready for it. It makes me wonder if I, when I even did the program at all. I was like, oh my God, did I even do it? Did I actually do it?
Well, one thing about the COVID is if something didn't go right, you can blame the COVID for everything that doesn't go right these days. Absolutely. So they said it was a COVID issue. So
there you go.
We'll see. Let me go back to Nat King Cole for just a minute.
And, sure.
Of course, his daughter turned out to be a huge star as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember being from Birmingham. I wasn't there, of course, but I remember the story of Nat King Cole coming to Birmingham.
Yes.
And can you just relate that story to us?
Sure. It happened in 1957. He was performing at a segregated concert, predominantly it was all white performance. What happened was that he was singing and the women that were in the audience just went crazy because he had such a smooth voice. He's an amazing crooner that there were like these six white men that got really, really angry with him. And as a result, they actually stormed on the stage. They actually beat him up on stage. The police had to basically separate the guys, arrest them, had to take him to the hospital. He was seriously injured actually during that. And he was doing the show while it was going on. He was just trying to raise, continue to, bring more, trying to promote the show and people to come up there watching on television, but he was hurt and it kind of did affect him physically for a while. After a while, he was always had terrible back pain, and he told himself that he was never going to go back and he was never going to perform in Birmingham or Alabama again. And Alabama is his hometown. He was born there. That's his hometown. I mean, his home state. And it was very sad for him because during that entire situation, he had such a very an insouciant, kind of a nonchalant way of handling things. He never raised his temper because he knew that being an angry black man is not a good thing to be. And he knew that he was disappointed. He was hurt by it. But I think he was even more hurt even by his own community, particularly Thurgood Marshall, even at one time even called him a sellout or a coon because he wasn't angry enough, quote unquote, because of what happened to him. Because he was assaulted. But it's like, he was a man of faith. He believed that he needed to just, he had righteous anger, but he felt that in order for him to overcome his anger, he believed that he should go out there and perform in South America, do things that black people have never done before. He felt that his achievement, his accomplishments would be the thing that would carry him through instead of, him just, putting up a protest sign saying, I hate this. But that was his way of protesting, was just, beating the odds and trying to, I'll show you that I can do this without, in spite of what's going on. But that was a very, that was almost a scary period, that particular concert in Alabama.
Yeah, I remember that. Mychal, Barbara, you guys got anything else before we wrap it out?
Well, the one thing, and Thom, you kind of alluded to this, you talked about Natalie Cole, Nat King Cole's daughter.
Yeah.
I mean, I was wondering, in your story with Nat King Cole, and you know how they do some of the concerts now where they have the hologram of a celebrity or person come in. Had you thought about maybe doing something where you have Natalie and Nat together in your film or something like that, using those types of technology?
Well, here's the thing that is very interesting about it, because, Natalie Cole had been, performing around the same time with his father all of his life, because he prepared her to sing, because the whole family can sing. That his late wife Maria Cole, they were all singers. They're all, so that's all they did all the time. But I think for her to have like a national impact, she made her actual television debut on her show. So there's definitely going to be some scenes with that. And I think that the story really kind of starts and ends with Natalie, because she was also at the time, she was exceptionally an extremely shy person. She did not want to be on stage or on television. She was terrified. And ironically, when she started her television debut, like her as a solo artist, It was on the same studio lot that he actually did that his father did a show. So, and it was on the Flip Wilson show. That was his first time. It was 1975. She released that song, This Will Be. And she won a Grammy for that. She won a Grammy for Best New Artist in 1975. And that started her career as well. But I think I've read different bios about her that her, you know, besides, you know, the dealing with, you know, the drug issue. She always felt that she always was under the shadow of her father. Everybody thought you should be just like your dad. And she just wanted to be her own person. But, you know, when she did her Unforgettable album, which I think she's recorded 30 years ago, it was released in 1991, the following year, it was just almost the fact that, hey, you know, I'm just going to embrace who I am. So it was like when she embraced who she was, you know, that she's more than just, you know, Nat King Cole's daughter. You know, she was a, you know, she's a woman who loved her father enough to be able to respect her music. And that just made her like the biggest star in the world. And fortunately now, you know, both of them are, you know, are in glory. They're in heaven right now. So it's just sad to see that. It's really sad because it's only sad that the only remaining family members that are left, I think, are the twin daughters. They're the only ones that are alive. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, because I think they had four, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. They had 5 kids. And I think that three out of the 4 children have passed. Maria passed, I think, in 2011. And the father died, and Nat King Cole died in 1965. He was actually, he was about 40s.
Wow.
46 years old. He was a young man.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's all that music, that legacy still goes on forever.
Well, Eric, man, we just want to thank you for coming on. It's been wonderful. It's been educational.
And, oh, thank you.
Definitely. It's been great. We'll have to get you back sometime. And the best for the 25 songs, you want to give out the contact information again?
Sure, most definitely. Songs? Yes, 25 Songs of Christmas is www.25songsofchristmas.com. It's a beautiful website. Please check it out. We got a lot of great contact there as well. And also, I have another website too. We also have we have morningstarmediagroup.org. That's our company that a production company that I co-own with my sister Leah Jones. So we do a lot of our theater. So if you want to know where our theater productions and our film content that we have, you can check that website out as well.
Okay. All righty. Well, thank you, man. Thank you, Mychal. Thank you, Barbara. It's been a great show. We're going to close it out here now with a closing commentary on Thanksgiving and thankfulness. And I've got 3 quotes I think are absolutely appropriate. One is, the most beautiful way to start and end the day is with a grateful heart. We should certainly count our blessings, but we should also make our blessings count. And there is always something to be thankful for. So I want to thank the audience. We appreciate you all being with us today. Thank Mychal, Barbara, the communicator. Thank Eric Jones. And thank our sponsor, Best Girl. If you're interested in having your business to be a sponsor of the show, get in touch with us at Thom@BestGurl, thom@BestGurl.com. Let's have a happy Thanksgiving to M and J and to your grandma. Tell her we said happy Thanksgiving. And that's a wrap. Enjoy yourself. Make every day count. Peace.